A memorial carved from stone in honor of Mohamed Bouazizi. On December 17, 2010, the 26-year-old street vendor set himself on fire in protest against police harassment. His dramatic act unleashed a revolt against the powers that be, spreading from his hometown across Tunisia and eventually to large parts of the Arab world. We're in Sidi Bouzid, birthplace of the uprising against then-President Zine El Abidine Ben Ali. We're about to embark on a tour of the country to examine whether the fight to oust the dictator has been worthwhile.
The Tunisian revolution helped us to cast off the shackles of the past.
Since the revolution, it's been a total disaster. Everything's gone. They just threw us away. We want to see Ben Ali and his wife Laila return.
Revolution or no revolution, nothing's changed here.
Tunisia is now a democracy. Never again will we allow a dictator to come to power here.
Good morning, a sunny, flowery, jasmine-y morning from Radio Karama from Sidi Bouzid.
Radio Karama, named after the Arab word for dignity, based in Sidi Bouzid. It was set up by Rabah Hajlaoui in August 2011 as an alternative source of information, especially for the younger generation in Sidi Bouzid and the surrounding region. The station provides an outlet for listeners to share their concerns and frustrations. Hajlaoui is pessimistic about Tunisia's fortunes.
The economic situation hasn't changed since 2011. The various governments have failed to implement the policies they promised. The situation that led to the revolution remains the same. We're still lacking basic infrastructure. There are no hotels. Potential investors don't even have a place to spend the night. So why would they invest here? Any politician with half a brain talks about Sidi Bouzid and the revolution, but only to win votes. The people of Sidi Bouzid don't believe politicians anymore. And that's when democracy is in danger.
How representative is the claim that democracy has disappointed the people of Sidi Bouzid? The region continues to be largely overlooked by government and business. Of the city's 40,000 residents, over half are unemployed, including many college graduates. We accompany local reporter Mufida Kaderi to gauge opinion on the streets as the country is gearing up for parliamentary elections on October 26th.
Has the revolution fulfilled the expectations of young people?
We had big expectations after the revolution. We expected investment and development projects, but nothing happened.
Why are you angry?
The situation the country's in.
Such as?
A lot of things.
For example?
There's no funding for farmers like me.
Like investment?
A sack of dung costs 35 dinars. I don't have that. Medicine and other things are also lacking. God willing, things will improve. I love farming, but that means having money.
So the farming sector hasn't improved?
Not a bit.
But you seem optimistic.
Thank God I'm doing a lot better than most.
So you think the situation has improved?
Don't things look normal here? Everybody has a job and food or a college place. Pupils are back at school. We have everything.
Terrorists are everywhere.
So the revolution was pointless?
The revolution destroyed us. What revolution? The old leaders will return and rule the country again. We've achieved nothing. The situation has only gotten worse. I wish everything had stayed the same as it used to be.
The revolution did secure freedom of speech for Tunisians. For most people, however, the standard of living remains low. We now move on from Sidi Bouzid, where our tour of the country began. The Sidi Bouzid governorate of central Tunisia is known for its fertile farmland, and it generates a third of the country's agricultural output. Almost half the rural population works in the fields. It could be more, but many young people are averse to the hard work and low pay involved. A campaign has been launched to attract more young men and women to farming, with the prospect of higher earnings. It provides special training courses in fruit and vegetable farming. Wahid Abidi used to be a supervisor. Now he's learning how to till the fields himself.
Farming is the future for this region. We don't have factories or any other real industry. Farming is the main source of income here. It's important for all young people to get the right training.
We continue our journey to the Gafsa governorate, a largely barren desert region. It's home to the world's fourth largest phosphate basin. Mining began over a century ago under the French colonial regime and was continued by the Tunisian government after independence in the 1950s. The chemical is an important export commodity and hard currency earner. Phosphate is processed to create fertilizer for farmers. Extracting it, however, has undesirable repercussions. We meet Hedi Radaoui, who's been campaigning for years to highlight the legacy of mining for the region.
Everything you see behind me is a result of phosphate mining. The phosphate is displaced by the state company using dynamite, a new method that has been employed for a few years now. But the blasts are not good for the environment. They are harmful to nature and people living here.
Hedi claims the area has the highest cancer rate in the country, and that some local children are born deformed. He then takes us 50 kilometers west of Gafsa to the mining town of Rediyef. Coming here, he says, is essential for understanding the causes of the 2011 revolution. Revolution was already brewing here in 2008 due to social issues and the state mining company rigging recruitment to give jobs to regime-friendly workers. The resulting protests were brutally crushed by the government. A memorial in the center of town honors the memory of the victims. Adnan Haji was among the leaders of the protests. He was jailed and tortured. But the former dissident remains committed to the cause. He's now an independent candidate for the upcoming parliamentary and presidential elections. Almost 4 years after the popular uprising against the old regime, he finds it hard to see the positives.
The revolution achieved nothing. Our situation remains poor. Everything's the same as before the revolt we began in Rediyef in 2008. We called for economic development, a fairer distribution of the country's wealth, social justice, transparency, concern for the environment, and improved health services in the region. And all that remains our goal.
Adnan Haji makes grave allegations against the state apparatus.
Corruption is firmly entrenched in Tunisia, from the first president Bourguiba to Ben Ali and today. All the surveys indicate that corruption has become far more prevalent since Ben Ali left.
There's bribery, nepotism, and secret deal-making in all sectors. The region's administration is controlled by mafia-style people. They get all the big contracts. The mafia here comprises businessmen and corrupt state officials. They get their palms greased and burn taxpayers' money. The phosphate mining company is also corrupt.
Haji is determined to ensure the casualties of the original revolt in Red Dief will not have died in vain. Despite the disaffection, his fight for social justice is far from over. We take a look around the city on our own. The phosphate deposits earn the Tunisian government billions, but precious little seems to trickle down to the locals. On the mining company grounds, we come across a number of women on hunger strike. They're demanding jobs for themselves or family members. Red Dief has precious few other work opportunities.
The company brought charges against us because we've been having a sit-in here at the entrance. But what is our crime? We just want to make our opinion public. We're disappointed. We thought the company would help us, but instead it had us charged by the police. I make henna. My brother's a farmer and has five children, but no work. My sister also has five children, but she and her husband are jobless. I'm the only one who supports them. I'd give the shirt off my back. What am I supposed to do? Help myself or the others?
We're shown around the mining company premises by a member of staff. After being unemployed for years, Mohamed Radadi managed to get a job at the factory in 2013. Out of solidarity with those less fortunate, he and like-minded staff go on strike almost every month. That commitment costs him financially, but it's a price he's willing to pay.
In 2008, I was among those who took to the streets to demand freedom and jobs. Today, I'm supporting the sit-in. I know the suffering that poverty and unemployment mean, so of course, I'm supporting them.
That evening, we're back in Gafsa, where Hedi Radoui introduces us to a group of young men. They all have college degrees, but none has a job. As so often, the discussion revolves around their personal situation, social conditions, and the performance of politicians, none of which they're happy with.
The problem is they all have their own agenda. The politicians have failed to integrate the everyday people who want social change and jobs.
The parties made promises they couldn't keep. Now young people are saying, I voted for you because of the promises you made. So what happened?
Let's be realistic. The problems from the last decade can't be solved in 2 or 3 years.
None of the young men wish for a return of Ben Ali, but democracy so far hasn't fulfilled their hopes either.
The old system is back, with new clothes. Actually, things are even worse than in the old days. Most of the candidates for the presidential elections are businessmen. I don't think they'll help the country progress. They have no plans for new jobs. All they want is immunity to let them rob the country.
The unemployed have one enemy, the power elites in Tunis, who have good connections in the country and abroad. They're exploiting the country's riches. It's all about a few thieves, while everyone else is exploited.
So was the Tunisian revolution and the lives of over 300 people killed in the uprising against Ben Ali in vain? The widespread frustration here and in other neglected parts of Tunisia seems dangerously close to reigniting. Our next destination is the island of Djerba, off the east coast of the country. On the way, we stop at one of the many illegal but state-tolerated gas stations that have popped up since 2011. Gasoline smuggled in from neighboring Algeria costs half the regular official price. Another feature of post-revolutionary Tunisia. Djerba is a major tourist destination, traditionally attracting several million foreign visitors every year. Since the revolution in 2011, however, those figures have dropped significantly, and that's a major problem for the 400,000 Tunisians who work in the tourism sector. The country has traditionally catered to vacationers seeking low-cost deals. But new initiatives have been started recently promoting a new kind of tourism. El Riad is a village in central Djerba. Off the beaten track, the only feature of interest to most tourists until now was the old synagogue. This summer, however, the village was turned into a giant canvas. 150 street artists from across the world descended on El Riad to join Djerbahood. The project invited them to paint motifs and murals on traditional houses and buildings, and was the brainchild of Mehdi Ben Chaik.
I chose the village because of its authenticity and fantastic architecture. I wanted to connect the typical southern Mediterranean style with street art. It's a brand new form of art. Bringing the two worlds together is an explosive mix.
The project is intended to attract more visitors to the village and promote Tunisia as a tolerant country.
It was originally a Jewish village. Christians and Muslims live here too. They've all been coexisting here for centuries. It's a great example if you look at all the developments in the Middle East right now. It's possible for everyone to live side by side in peace. People should stop making us believe we have to be enemies. It isn't true.
The giant outdoor gallery has already proved a boon for local residents who had previously seen little tourism. The visitors bring much-needed money into El Riad, while the locals have proved enthusiastic participants themselves in the Djerbahood project. That evening, we're in the island's main town of Humtsuk. Halime Fatnasi set up a bed and breakfast here 4 years ago with her Belgian husband. It's in a lovingly renovated traditional townhouse. There are only three rooms, but it boasts the kind of intimate, authentic atmosphere that's lacking in the big hotels where Halima used to work. Opening up her own B&B was an act of liberation.
The revolution was very important for us. Finally, we felt the country belonged to us. What began at the end of 2010 is a big challenge, but it's a great feeling for ordinary Tunisians. And suddenly, you begin to dream.
Living the kind of dream that would have been virtually impossible in the old days. The next morning, we leave Djerba for the mainland. During the short ferry crossing, we happen to meet a Libyan couple, eager for a break from their war-torn homeland next door.
I spent 3 days in Jerba, the best 3 days of my life. If you compare the situation with Libya, Tunisia is far better. The Tunisian revolution is the only one that has succeeded.
The next stage in our journey takes us 500 kilometers north to Tunis, the capital and largest city in Tunisia. The problems we witnessed in Sidi Bouzid and Gafsa seem non-existent in this buzzing modern urban hub with a fair share of upscale neighborhoods. People here seem more relaxed in what is one of the most liberal cities in North Africa. After the widespread disillusionment elsewhere, we finally get the opportunity to meet the people who will determine the country's political and economic future. We go to the Tunisian parliament, which remains the focal point of political life. Over the last 3 years, the new parliament has seen heated debates over new laws and the new constitution finalized in January. Now, on the final day of the legislative period, the politicians are exhausted. We ask the vice chair of the National Constituent Assembly, a member of the Islamist Ennahda party, about complaints raised by the electorate.
Remember that there's been a revolution and that one of the biggest causes was a lack of freedom. That has been resolved. But expectations have naturally been high in terms of economic development and jobs. So I can understand young people who wonder how they benefit from this emerging democracy.
Merezia Naabadi insists that the newly won freedom of speech, however, provides the foundation for a brighter political future in Tunisia.
We forged a spirit of democracy and freedom in this parliament, which wasn't easy. I've presided over 65% of sessions, and it's been a constant struggle to distinguish between free speech and valid criticism and resorting to insults and disrespectful invective.
Être libre de dire ce qu'on vraiment pense, contredire l'autre, le critiquer et ne pas tomber dans.
Those members of parliament who, like all Tunisians, had to keep their mouths shut for so long under the dictatorship tend to cross that line very quickly.
Des députés qui, comme tous les Tunisiens, ils ont vécu longtemps en silence sous la dictature. La frontière.
But step by step, we've achieved a high degree of freedom in parliament.
Je pense qu'on a développé quelque chose qui est acquise maintenant, qui est le plafond des libertés est très haut dans l'hémicycle.
In those corridors of power, we meet Selma Mabrouk, representing the Social Democratic Al-Masar Party. She welcomes the new debating freedom in parliament, but fears some of her fellow politicians taking liberties with democracy.
Malheureusement, on n'a pas réglé au niveau législatif.
Neither the parliament nor the government have passed legislation for more transparency. Unfortunately, that has meant a recipe for continued corruption. Some of the parliamentarians here are the subject of rumors about their honesty, about conflicts of interest, and even bribes. Some are said to have taken bribes to change parties.
Ils auraient adhéré à un parti juste parce que le chef du parti leur aurait payé une commission.
Politicians like Selma Mabrouk want to see an end to such corruption and other clandestine backroom dealings. Outside Parliament, too, Tunisians are fighting for more transparency. We visit the activist group Alba Salah, meaning compass. They began monitoring the work of their parliament and its committees 2 years ago. The young activists keep a detailed online record of the laws debated and how politicians vote.
L'idée ici, c'est de retracer les votes des élus
The idea is to track the voting behavior of parliamentarians on laws. Here you can see the official seat distribution, and there the voting results. Green means in favor, yellow abstain, and red against.
This is another precedent in Tunisia, ordinary citizens surveilling their politicians' every move. It's a right that was hard fought in this still young democracy, says Ansbel Abdel Karim of Al Basala.
We have 50 years of dictatorship behind us with minimal transparency. People had no access to information. We had no idea how political decisions were made and implemented. So it was important to create a new culture of transparency with the politicians accountable to the people who voted for them. Our greatest achievement was to make it clear to most members of parliament that we were there to inform people, to understand their work. They saw that it was to their benefit. The more they dealt in the dark, the more attacks there were on them.
It's also thanks to the tireless efforts of activists like Ons and her friends that Tunisia remains on the democratic path. After the revolution, there was another conflict with the potential to polarize. The question of what role Islam would play in politics. After Tunis, we drive down to the town of Nabaoul, 70 kilometers away. The Nida Tunis party is holding a rally for November's presidential election. Its candidate needs no introduction to Tunisians. Beji Kaid Essebsi, who founded the party just 2 years ago to target secular voters. The man looking to keep the Islamists out of power is an 87-year-old veteran of the political arena. He held several cabinet posts under Ben Ali's predecessor, Habib Bourguiba, and more recently was prime minister between February and December 2011. He now has a decent chance of becoming the next head of state and doesn't shy away from patriotic gestures. A few days later, we meet Essebsi in his office. How does he think the conflict between Islamists and secularists will pan out?
The next elections will decide whether Tunisia becomes a modern progressive country or whether Tunisians want a different model. I believe they will vote for a progressive state.
His party's chief rival is the Ennahda party, led by Rachid Ghannouchi. After years of imprisonment under the Ben Ali regime, Ghannouchi fled to London before returning over two decades later in 2011. He rejects suggestions that his party is dangerous.
We spent 2 years in government and did not interfere with people's lives. Women are free to decide whether they want to wear a headscarf or go to the beach, the mosque, or a discotheque. In those 2 years, Tunisians did not have the feeling that they were being oppressed by Ennahda. That's just propaganda.
فرضت عليهم النهضة فهذه دعايات باطلة يعني Whoever ends up heading the next government will be judged primarily on the ability to rejuvenate the struggling economy, increase production capacity, and reduce unemployment in rural areas. While entire regions in the provinces are in a desperate economic state, the country's wealth is concentrated in Tunis and a handful of other coastal cities close to it. What everyone agrees on is that the ousted Ben Ali regime is to blame for the country's woes. In their 23 years in power, Ben Ali and his family plundered the country's assets. All the lucrative areas of the economy were divvied up between relatives of the president and his wife, Leila Trabelsi. Brothers, nephews, and sons-in-laws were gifted real estate and luxury imported cars, as well as stakes in banks, construction firms, and retail chains, telecommunications operators, airlines, and media groups. Undesirable competitors were sidelined, and there was no fair trade in any sense of the word. Foreign importers were largely obliged to pay kickbacks to the clan. The resulting damage to the economy is astronomical, with up to 15 billion euros lost. Former banker Ezzedine Zaidani has expert knowledge of that pervasive corruption and cronyism.
Surveys conducted in Tunisia and by the World Bank have shown that corruption has cost the country 2% growth per year. That's a huge figure. It corresponds to around 30 to 35,000 jobs lost each year due to corruption. Today, the situation has changed. Corruption has not disappeared. On the contrary, it's worsened since the revolution due to the weakening of the state and administration.
Despite his own efforts to recover the billions embezzled by the Ben Ali clan, Zaidani doubts that Tunisia will ever recover all its stolen assets. He's now primarily concerned with the future.
Corruption isn't down to particular individuals. It's an entire system. Some of the people have gone, but the system is still there. What matters here is putting in place the necessary institutions and control mechanisms to prevent the system of corruption from working, or at least not on the same scale. Corruption exists in every country in the world and has done so in all civilizations. It's a question of scale.
Ben Ali is gone, but corruption remains ubiquitous. The younger generation refuses to put up with the situation. iWatch is a watchdog group set up in the throes of the revolution in 2011. Women are particularly hard hit by corruption, reveals 23-year-old Manel Benachour. She runs a project that aims to give a voice to younger Tunisian women. A special conference sees countless testimony from women about their experience of corruption, where nobody and no area of life is spared.
Earlier, we had a case where a woman informed us of corruption in the public sector, specifically at a hospital. When she wanted to give birth, she was asked to pay a bribe. This is really a case of humanitarian assistance. It was unacceptable. This was a public hospital supposed to serve everybody, including the poor, and they exploited them. We're talking about a criminal gang setup, comprising staff and the hospital director.
Year-old Maya Mrawa has had frequent run-ins with bribe demands. She tells us what happened after a public assault.
A young woman said she knew the man and gave me his address and phone number. When I went to the police station, they knew him too. They knew where he lived and said they would bring him in for questioning. And then an officer came to me, and he said he was a friend of the culprit. He said I shouldn't make a fuss. Then he said, if you want him to be charged, give me an advance of 200 dinars. I need the bribe to pay a friend so that he'll bring in the suspect.
The police and Tunisia's other security forces were a crucial instrument in Ben Ali's rule of oppression. They protected his iron grip on power and routinely used intimidation and torture to keep the country's citizens in check. So is that abuse of power a thing of the past? Former soldier Bassem Bouguera is now a software developer and head of an activist group that calls for a more democratic police force.
I would say that the security apparatus in Tunisia today is the biggest threat to democratic transition in Tunisia. Why? Because no government would want to mess with the security system that exists today. No government would want to create a construction within that security institution because he will get a lot of backfire, and then he will get a huge resistance from the police officers because they don't want any change.
Bouguera discovered the hard way just how virulent that resistance is, as this video of him being beaten shows. And he warns,
if the police want change, or they want change their techniques, and they want change their philosophy, or they want change their way of doing work, they'll be used by the next government to oppress their opposition.
Do the Tunisian police still pose a threat to the fledgling democracy? Are they a force that still needs to be reined in? We asked Chokri Hamada, spokesman of the country's biggest police union. He denies any such accusations.
The security forces showed after the revolution that they're neutral and independent. They abide by the law and the constitution passed earlier this year. They work for the Tunisian people and will continue to serve the whole country and its security.
Has the Tunisian police indeed conducted its own democratic transition? Human rights activist Bokra Belhaj Mida says no.
Human rights have been violated daily since the revolution. Arrests, torture, and worse. It's not as bad as during the Ben Ali era. There's no more systematic torture. What we do have is human rights violations, such as arbitrary detention for resisting the police. People who believed they were defending themselves legally. This is an everyday occurrence. The only real achievement is a strong civil society that will resist authoritarian tendencies.
Qui va résister, quelle que soit la tentation autoritaire.
Moving out of the shadow of authoritarian rule is a hard but necessary step. Rached Jaidan knows of the potential danger lurking. In 1993, the mathematician and fellow opposition figures were thrown into jail without trial and tortured.
Il y a beaucoup de militants qui ont succombé, qui ont tombé, qui sont tombés martyrs.
A lot of activists died as martyrs.
Qui étaient très malades, qui n'ont pas eu droit.
In many cases, the authorities denied basic medical care to activists who were very sick.
Banal, hein? C'était très grave.
I witnessed torture and was a victim of it myself.
De torture. J'étais moi-même torturé.
Like many others, I was assaulted by prison staff, police, and in fact, even members of the state security forces.
What does he expect from the state now?
There can be no material compensation. No money can compensate for 18 years of a person's life. What I want to see
is the state accepting responsibility for this part of Tunisia's history, for the martyrs who died and those who were tortured, so this can never happen again in the future. The members of the old regime have to admit their mistakes, which they refuse to do. They claim to be patriots who are just doing their duty. But that isn't true. For 23 years, they supported the dictatorship. This is something they have to acknowledge so that we can look ahead to the future.
The goal is a stable democracy with rights and opportunities for all citizens. That entails a government doing its job instead of politicians lining their own pockets while oppressing the people. Will Tunisians actually succeed where other Arab states failed? Democracies depend on the commitment and protection of the people, and Tunisia will be no exception. We end our tour in Sidi Bou Said, just a few kilometers away from downtown Tunis. Thanks to tourism and wealthy local residents, the picturesque village is a world away from the problems besetting other parts of the country. That promise has seen growing numbers of Tunisians moving in from poorer parts of the region. Now 25, Mohamed Ali Ben Amar has not had a job since he graduated from high school. But disillusionment has not blinded him to the value of hard-fought democratic reforms to his country.
Democracy is a new experience for Tunisia. It's something we have to nurture. Democracy is complicated, and it's not easy to learn in our country. We're taking our first steps together. As politically aware young people, we have to treat democracy carefully, like a baby.